This video is brought to you by Brilliant. You're going to learn more about Brilliant later in today's video, but if you want to learn more about them right now, go to brilliant.org/brainfood. You'll also find a link in the description below. So in the video today, we're answering a viewer question because Marb Leezy asks us, how did the ancient Romans manage to build perfectly straight roads hundreds of miles long? The ancient Romans were a people famed for their architectural prowess, something no better demonstrated than by their ability to build almost perfectly straight and incredibly durable roads spanning expansive distances. For example, in Britain alone, the Romans built over 50,000 miles of roads, with the longest ruler straight stretch spanning over 50 miles. They did all of this in an era without modern surveying tools, construction equipment, or even very accurate maps of precisely where their destination was for many of the areas. So, well, how did they do it? To begin with, it's important to note that there were a few different types of road that were made throughout the Roman Republic and Empire, and the exact method and materials used for road construction varied somewhat from region to region and evolved slightly over the centuries. With that caveat out of the way, the three main classifications of Roman roads were via Terrani, essentially dirt roads often made by people walking and wagons riding over the same path over time, via Glarii, which was a dirt road that was then graveled, and finally, much more interestingly, via Munitia, which were more or less paved roads, some of which have survived through modern times. With these types of roads, there were further classifications based on who could use them, such as public roads, military or state roads, and private roads constructed at private expense and for the owners to decide who they allowed access to, and this could perhaps be the general public or perhaps just a select few. To help pay for them, roads of all types often had tolls, particularly at locations like bridges and city gates, where it would be impractical to avoid the tolling location. So this brings us to the road construction process itself. As dirt and gravel roads are not particularly interesting, we're going to focus this video on paved roads. So how did they make these incredibly durable and generally straight roads? After all, even with modern machinery, constructing and maintaining an expansive road system is an extremely time-consuming and labor-intensive process. To start with, a group of surveyors would be sent out to figure out the precise direction connecting the two main points. At the same time, they'd attempt to plan the route as efficiently as possible while accounting for any major obstacles like tall mountains, rivers, etc. When possible, they may attempt to avoid such obstacles, but particularly in some of the earliest Roman road constructions where it might result in having to take a large detour to get around, for example, a mountain, if possible given the terrain, they tended just to build the road to go directly over the mountain or directly through it. For example, the longest tunnel through such a mountain was the Grotta di Cocceo, which was excavated from 38 to 36 BCE and is approximately 1 kilometer, that's 0.62 miles long, and about 5 meters, 5.4 yards high and wide. Before World War II, it was also still a fully functional and safe to traverse tunnel, despite standing for about 2,000 years at that point, but unfortunately it was damaged during the war, though there are presently efforts going on to have it repaired and reopened to the public. As for going over a mountain, it's important to note here that we don't mean they'd use switchbacks as is the general method today. No, if at all possible, they'd just build roads straight up over a mountain and down the other side, expecting that soldiers and mules and the like would just man up and traverse the steep slopes without complaint. That said, as the empire matured, it did eventually become apparent that there were economic advantages to slightly longer roads that were easier for draft animals to pull carts over, and thus there was a shift to favoring longer distances, but lesser gradients when talking roads for general public use. Either way, during the process, the surveyors would set up markers, often at very visible points like on hills, mapping out the optimal path, again trying to ensure that the road would be as straight as possible between the start and the end point to reduce needed labor, materials, and distance needed to traverse the road once it was complete. So this all brings us to how they actually ensured perfectly straight roads between the markers. A key tool here was a device known as a gromer. In a nutshell, this was nothing more than a sort of cross with four weights hanging from a string at each end of the cross to function as plumb lines. The whole thing could rotate with degree markers on top. Two of the plumb lines would then be lined up with a marker and then on the other side lined up with the previous marker. Where changes in direction would need to be made, the degrees were marked and ultimately the whole thing drawn up on a central document showing the entire route of the road with each segment. Once the actual construction was to begin, the groomer would once again be used, this time with rods pounded into the grounds between markers, using the groomer to make sure that every single rod was perfectly in line between the markers. Now, finally, construction of the road would start, usually first done via plows to loosen the soil. This would be followed by legionnaires and/or slaves digging the ground out, with depth varying based on conditions. For instance, swampy lands would need a lot thicker foundation if it was to have any staying power. For more typical grounds, the trench needed to be somewhere in the realm of 3 to 6 feet, that's around 1 to 2 meters deep. Once dug out, this would then be tamped down to a leveled, compact layer of earth. From here, the exact road composition varied based on available materials in a given region, as well as land composition and a bunch of other factors like this. But typically, large stones would be packed as tightly as possible together and into the earth base. Onto this layer would usually be placed smaller stones, sometimes comprising broken concrete or somewhat crushed rock. Again, it would be packed and smoothed as best as possible. Depending on availability, they would also put a layer of sand on this foundation to make a genuinely perfectly smooth surface. On top of all of this, at the minimum, gravel would be added, packed, and leveled. In some cases, such as near big cities, as described in one manuscript on the construction of roads in Rome itself, paving stones, often flint, lava rock, or marble, would be embedded in cement for the top layer instead. When the road was complete, they are thought to have been quite smooth, allowing for relatively bump-free travel in carts and things like that. During this whole process, special attention was taken to making the center of the road higher than the sides so that any water would drain off, with the entire road surface itself also elevated above the ground, so on the sides drainage ditches could be put, and these would generally help move water away in times of heavy rains. As for the size of the roads, according to something known as the Law of 12 Tables, which more or less formed the basis of Roman law for almost a millennia, Roman roads were required to be at minimum 8 Roman feet wide, about 2.5 meters, where the road was straight, and double that if the road happened to be curved. Beside the roads were footpaths, sometimes gravels, which were particularly handy in the case of private roads, where only people with proper authorization could use the road itself. Finally, at the very outer edges of the roads, any nearby trees and bushes would be removed to help reduce areas for bandits to hide and surprise anyone with an attack. It also helped to ensure that plant growth didn't overtake the road or tree roots compromise it. But this still wasn't the end of the construction process. They now needed to know exact distances along the road. It's not fully clear how they did this, though a device known as the odometer of Vitruvius is mentioned starting around 27 BC and is often claimed to have been used for this purpose. However, whether it was actually ever used for road construction or even made at all is still up for debate. At a high level, this device used the spinning of a wheel to mark distance. In this case, it was the spinning of a wagon wheel, which was in turn hooked up to gears that would drop a pebble into a container every Roman mile. That's 4,841 feet, which is around 1,000 paces for an adult male. Indeed, the word mile derives from the Latin milia, meaning, funnily enough, 1,000 paces. For whatever it's worth, while Leonardo da Vinci tried and failed to make such a device as per outlined, in 1981, one Andre Sleeswyck was successful in building one exactly as described, except unlike da Vinci, he used triangular gear teeth instead of square ones. His justification for this modification being that these same type of gear teeth were used in the Antikythera mechanism, which was created sometime from around 250 to 70 BC, with the device itself used to predict various astronomical phenomena like eclipses. Perhaps if the odometer of Vitruvius was ever actually built and used, maybe it had these too. There are, of course, many other, much less technologically advanced ways they could have measured mile distances easily enough with extreme accuracy. However they did it, at every mile mark, the law required them to place an approximately 2-ton, 7-foot-tall, with 2 feet in the ground, mile marker called a millarium. Helpfully, on this stone would be engraved the names of the locations the road connected to and how many miles to each one from that respective marker it was. A master marker known as the Millario Aureae, or Golden Milestone, was also created during Caesar Augustus's rule and placed in the central forum of Rome itself. This was the one point at which all Roman roads were said to lead. It's not actually clear what was on this master marker, but it's been speculated that it listed the distances from that point to all major cities under Roman rule. Whatever the case, like the roads themselves, some of these mile markers are still standing today, giving archaeologists and historians a valuable snapshot of the past, since they tended to include not just basic geographic information, but information about when the road was built or repaired, and by whom. Next up, it was also required by law that regular way stations be built for official use, generally every 16 to 19 miles apart. These were more or less really nice resting areas, providing food and drink and the like for the officials. For the general public, inns would tend to pop up near these way stations. On that note, at particularly high-trafficked way stations, many other businesses would pop up as well, sometimes leading to the creation of whole towns. Along these roads, you'd also find, at similar intervals, changing stations where people could get the services of veterinarians, wheelwrights, etc., as well as potentially find new mounts. To give you an idea of how fast one could move along these roads with its network of way stations and facilities, it's noted that Emperor Tiberius once traversed about 200 miles in 24 hours after news that his brother was dying from gangrene after being seriously injured falling from a horse. A more typical time to traverse for, say, a government mail carrier was usually about 50 miles per day, if not in a particular hurry. But to sum it up, it turns out that Roman road construction, amenities and all, wasn't all that different from modern times, often featuring deep foundations, paved surfaces, proper drainage, landscaping around the roads, sidewalks, toll booths, rest areas, hotels, restaurants, the historic equivalent of gas stations and convenience stores, etc. In short, the ancient Romans, they were pretty brilliant in a lot of ways. And speaking of brilliance, this video sponsored by Brilliant. Brilliant believe that learning math, science, and computer science doesn't have to be dull. To that end, they've put together courses that are all about storytelling, interactive challenges, and solving problems. It's a hands-on approach that is just a really excellent way to learn, and currently they've got over 50 courses. Now, look, you're halfway through an educational video, so you're probably the curious type, and Brilliant is a great way to take that curiosity just a step further and understand the world even more. For example, you could absolutely check out their course on geometry fundamentals, super relevant to this video, where you'll learn things like angle axioms, 3D geometry, coordinates, and much more. It's a great intro to how geometry is used in the real world today. So effective learning is all about problem solving, and Brilliant help you learn and practice just that. It's a great complement to videos like this. I mean, it's all good to learn something here, but you can take things a step deeper with Brilliant. So if you want to support Today I Found Out and get unlimited access to all of Brilliant's in-depth maths and science courses, just go to brilliant.org/brainfood. You can get 20% off their premium annual subscription. And let's get into those bonus facts. The infamous phrase, Nero fiddled while Rome burned, has come to mean a person who is neglecting their duties, probably by doing something frivolous. But did Nero actually sit around and play music while Rome was burning around him in 64 AD? To begin, there was such a fire, though its extent is unknown. According to Tacitus, the fire lasted for 6 days and decimated Rome, with only 4 districts untouched out of 14. He goes on to state that 10 of the 11 districts that burned were heavily damaged, with 3 of those completely destroyed. However, oddly, there is very little documented mention of the fire from those who actually lived through it. The only Roman historian during that period who even mentioned it was Pliny the Elder, and even he only mentioned it briefly in passing. Had it been as widespread as Tacitus claimed, one would think that the likes of Plutarch, Epictetus, or other famed Roman historians who lived through the fire would have mentioned it as a significant event. And indeed, we see that perhaps it wasn't that great of a fire from the only other documented first-hand account of the scope of the disaster, a letter from Seneca the Younger to Paul the Apostle, where he explicitly stated that only 4 blocks of insulae were burned. These were a type of apartment building, along with 132 private houses being damaged, which was about 7% of the private houses in the city. In terms of the insulae, this was only about 0.009% of them. So basically, it was not anywhere close to as widespread as Tacitus later claimed, though Seneca did say the fire lasted 6 days, as Tacitus stated. As to Nero's reaction to the fire, the first and biggest flaw in the fiddling story is that the fiddle, or violin, didn't actually exist in Nero's time. Historians aren't able to give an exact date for the invention of the violin, but the viol class of instruments to which the violin belongs wasn't developed until at least the 11th century. If Nero did actually play a stringed instrument, and there's no evidence that he did, whether during the burning of Rome or otherwise, it was probably a lyre or a kithara. Okay, so some details can get muddled through history, but did Nero neglect Rome while it burned? Historians argue that probably not. Reports do place Nero 35 miles away from Rome at the time of the fire, as he was staying in his villa at Antium. However, an account from Tacitus tells us that he returned to Rome immediately when word of the fire reached him in order to begin relief efforts. As the fire raged on, Nero even opened up his own gardens to provide a temporary home for those who were now homeless. He also ordered the construction of emergency accommodation and cut the price of corn, as well as provided food directly so that people could eat. Besides that, he paid for much of these relief efforts out of his own pocket. However, Tacitus also tells us of the rumor that had spread among the masses. While the flames surged through the city, Nero stood on his private stage and sang about the destruction of Troy in a comparison of the two events. Whether or not the rumor had any evidence to back it up or was just something made up by the unhappy masses, we don't know, but this and Suetonius's account are the most likely source of the fiddle story that we hear today. Unfortunately for Nero, at least in the context of the story, he did have a reputation for enjoying concerts and participating in music competitions, so the activity itself wasn't entirely unlikely, even if the timing of the act is highly questionable. While Tacitus claims the singing story was a rumor, Suetonius wrote about it with conviction. However, the story could have been an attempt to further mar Nero's name. Nero faced problems during his reign from the very start when it was reported that his own mother poisoned his predecessor Claudius. He was also blamed for the death of Claudius's son Britannicus, who was being urged to take his proper place as emperor by overthrowing Nero. Numerous other deaths were thought to have been committed by Nero's hand, including one of his wives, and indeed his own mother. As such, Nero was painted as a man who was difficult for the masses to trust. No one knew how the fire started, and many Romans believed that he had actually started the fire that burned the city. It actually likely started in shops containing flammable goods and was probably an accident rather than one person's intentional act. With the mob out for blood, Nero was forced to turn to a scapegoat and blame Christians for starting the fire. There were only a small number of Christians in Rome at the time, and they were considered a strange religious sect, so they were an easy target. As Tacitus stated, "Consequently, to get rid of the report, Nero fastened the guilt and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations, called Christians by the populace. Christus, from whom the name has its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus, and a most mischievous superstition, thus checked for the moment, again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome, where all things hideous and shameful from every part of the world find their center and become popular. Accordingly, an arrest was first made of all Christians who pleaded guilty to the fire. Then, upon their information, an immense multitude was convicted, not so much of the crime of firing the city as of hatred against mankind. Mockery of every sort was added to their deaths. Covered with the skins of beasts, they were torn by dogs and perished, or were nailed to crosses, or were doomed to the flames and burnt, to serve as a nightly illumination when daylight had expired." Even finding someone to blame for the fire, it didn't help Nero's plea of innocence. In the wake of the fire, he built a palace on top of some of the land cleared by the flames, which people argued he had been planning from the start, though this is highly unlikely as the place he built the new palace was over half a mile away from where the fire started. In addition to a new palace, Nero did provide for the reconstruction of the city, but rebuilding stretched the limits of Rome's treasury at the time. He was forced to devalue Roman currency, which was not a popular move. Nero ended up committing suicide, or at least begging his secretary to kill him when he lost the nerve to do it himself 4 years after the fire. Accounts of his life and of the time of the fire are highly contradictory. Further, Suetonius and Tacitus wrote their histories 50 years after Nero died, and Cassius Dio wrote his 150 years later. Many historians also think it likely that Nero was more popular with the people of Rome than he was with the senators, and as all three of the main sources were from the senatorial class, it's likely they carry more than a little bias against him, not unlike what happens with the popular history of Marie Antoinette, who popular culture remembers very differently than who the actual woman appeared to be. That being said, Tacitus did state that while Nero's death was welcomed by senators, the lower classes mourned his passing. So in the end, the implication that Nero fiddled while Rome burned, or played the lyre, sang a song, or neglected his duty in any way is likely the result of anti-Nero propaganda and an attempt to tarnish his name. The morality of many of his actions during his reign is open to debate, but the fiddling or playing music story is almost certainly a myth, unless he was playing to entertain the displaced masses that he'd taken in. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Don't forget to subscribe, hit that notification bell. Also, our sponsor for today's episode was brilliant. Please do check them out through the link below. And as always, thank you for watching.